Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the EduSat Network. Today, we are going to discuss the evolution of literary theory. And if you were tuned in yesterday, you would know that we discussed a part of it yesterday as well. And we are today going to take up the discussion from where we left off. And we will start by talking about John Locke. For this, we have with us in the studio our subject expert, Dr. Anand Prakash, retired professor, Department of English, University of Delhi. Thank you for being here, sir, and for educating us.
Thanks, Urvashi. yesterday, we left in the middle, and I take this opportunity in this lecture to once again go back to the 17th century, where we have a philosopher called John Locke, who connects with us in the 20th century and in the 19th century that we'll discuss very directly. So I thought I'll take up a few hints and a few ideas from him and then elaborate them in order to talk a little more focused on the 19th century and particularly Hegel that we began with. So who was John Locke? John Locke is a philosopher born in the 17th century. He's born in 1632. This is the period of very big struggles between the English Parliament, the British Parliament, and the King, the Sovereign. And when tussles happen at this level, then they in fact are reflections of pressures that are building up in the society at the lower level. These pressures get crystallized in different forms, and the most direct form in which they crystallize is the conflict that happens on the political plane. So John Locke is somewhere near the end of this particular phase, and the battle between the kind of war of words between the Parliament and the King Sovereign is at its fiercest, and he breathes that air which has a great deal of debate in it. And as a philosopher, sometime in the 1640s and 50s, he will start thinking about these issues in a different manner, siding with one group of the contenders and opposing the other one, but then at the same time keeping a kind of balance there. He's associated with empiricism again that we have explained earlier in our discussions. So to repeat, empiricism is the knowledge of the immediate reality with the help of the senses, the ears, the eyes, etc. And that if one is to think about society, then one doesn't have to go back to definitions and philosophical tradition and morality and ethical principles, but one has to straight away respond to the situation that is at hand. So that is what empiricism is, and it's a very great strength for theory and knowledge, because knowledge has to be not with philosophers, it has to be with the common people on the road. So empiricism brings that into focus. The second thing that I think of is the social contract, the same thing on which Hobbes also gave a thought, and the natural law. Now, natural law, I'll explain a little in detail later, but then naturally speaking, that is as products of nature and of society, all individuals are, all human beings are equal, and this equality is in nature, and the same has to be in society also. So John Locke's main interests as a theorist, as a philosopher, and as a thinker are metaphysics, epistemology, which we took up yesterday also. This is the theory of knowledge, how knowledge is produced, how knowledge finally starts informing other areas of life, and how it also at the same time learns from those other areas. So if you go into the theory aspect of knowledge, then you are practicing what is called epistemology. political philosophy that's there. Imagine that in the 17th century, almost all philosophers and thinkers were their name. I would be grappling with the political questions, and as I explained in the beginning, that was because the common people in England were asserting themselves as never before. There have been discontent, that incidents of discontent in the 16th century, but then this discontent was of a radically different nature, much more strong. And then education. Now, what is the purpose of education, and how is education conceived by people, you know, who believe in spreading a particular message? Now, this is the question. Today, of course, there are available a large number of theories about education, but in the initial sense, in the classical sense, education means taking some higher ideas to the masses at their level, so that their awareness is lifted up, it is strengthened, and that they become then the intelligent citizens of the country. And it is this mission of giving education to the common people that must have inspired John Locke also. So if you read his philosophy, it would not be of big words, of great references to the ancient philosophers. Of course, he would be inspired by them. He would have read them. He was a very well-read person. But then he would be talking in the language of the common people, and he would be talking about the issues that worry them, that trouble their minds. So this is what education in the classical sense is, and in this sense, John Locke was active in his own time in the middle of the 17th century when he started thinking about those big issues. Now imagine that, and this is what inspired me to go back to Locke to understand the 19th century mind, that Locke gave what is called a theory of the mind. Now this is remarkable, that somebody is talking not of the soul, not of certain obligations and all duties, etc. He is talking of the human mind, and he is giving a theory about it. And let's read this theory and then pick up a few phrases to understand what exactly he means by the theory of the mind. It is often cited as the origin of modern conceptions of identity and the self, figuring prominently in the work of later philosophers such as Hume, Rousseau, and Kant. Locke was the first one to define the self through a continuity of consciousness. He postulated that at birth, the mind was a blank slate or tabula rasa. So imagine how he's conceptualizing the working of the mind and its significance in human behavior. He is bringing in, let's say, the question of identity. Identity is a very important question in the 19th century and even in the 20th century. In fact, almost all writers about the name in the 20th century and 21st century talk about identity. In fact, if you realize, then there are political parties which fight on the agenda in India, which fight on the agenda of identity politics, as if they would like to define themselves and their state in the society of the time. So he is talking about the conception of identity then, and identity, according to him, is given by the working of the mind. If a human being did not have a mind, then that human being, then humans would not have a sense of identity, a sense of selfhood. And I like the question, who am I? What am I supposed to do? Do I differ? Do I agree with the other person? If I don't agree, then what is my point of view? So all these questions related to one's individual perception, they actually emanate from the issue of identity that a person has. The other important point in this particular description is the continuity of consciousness. So human beings are conscious beings. They think, they relate, they are guided by their thinking, and their thinking then is a product of their actual human endeavor. So consciousness is a very important thing, and all of us know that even though animals are conscious about certain things, but the way we understand the term in the case of human beings that is absent in the animals, because there is no continuity of consciousness, in the sense, you know, that animals don't have the capacity to think consistently, to think continuously. And this continuous thinking actually develops and produces what is called consciousness according to Locke. And then he also gave an interesting theory which is being contested now by 20th century philosophers and thinkers. He said that at birth, the mind of an individual is a blank slate or a tabula rasa. It doesn't have anything. And when different images, different ideas, different impressions are being put on the mind, then the mind starts absorbing those things, comparing them, contrasting them, working them out, sorting them out, and finally develops what is called an attitude. So, but you know, it's an important thing. Otherwise, you know, in the religious parlance in Europe at that time, God is supposed to breathe, you know, consciousness into the soul of the human being. I'm quoting from the Bible, and from that time onwards, the human being is a person who is the best creation of God with the mind and all those things. Of course, on this there are a large number of debates, and I don't have the time to go into them. But then, according to this person, when a human being is born, his mind is completely blank. It is only later that he or she starts understanding the ways of the world. And if you, because most of the listeners, most of the viewers, you are students of literature, so you would realize that romantics also more or less thought of the same thing, that human beings in the beginning were quite near God, but not near society at all. You must have read that famous Ode on Intimations of Immortality by Wordsworth, who says, that child is quite close to God in the beginning, but then he starts, grappling with the affairs of the world and becomes a human being, a social being, and forgets and then severs all connection with God. So the entire poem is given on this, and maybe it is partly inspired by the idea of people like Locke, that the human mind in the beginning is pure and simple. And in the words of Locke, it is the tabula rasa. This is the theory, and if you go into this theory, then you can deal with it in philosophy. You can also deal with it in literature, as Wordsworth did, as Milton would have done much before him. And you know that Milton and Locke were contemporaries. Milton was a greater activist than Locke, but Locke was into the philosophy and thinking of about the issues. Then, enlightening observation we come across in Locke, and that is, since the mind in all thoughts and reasonings has no other immediate object but its own ideas, which it alone does or can contemplate, it is evident that our knowledge is only conversant with about them. What is he saying? He refers to what is called the content of the mind is ideas, and mind is working on the ideas alone, which means that the mind is not basically thinking about the world around it, but only about the ideas that the mind receives from the world. So the only content, the only substance that the mind has to work with are the ideas. Now, viewers, you may or may not agree with this, but then this is a very sound kind of a beginning for the philosopher to understand the working of the mind vis-a-vis itself. And if the mind is producing ideas and then is working with them, then perhaps that is what he means by identity of a human being. So you receive, you get ideas, you start working on the ideas, and then you develop the capacity to know things better. So it is evident that our knowledge is only conversant about them, means ideas. So once again, something about the human mind, and later on I have another quotation from him. The last one was not a quotation, that was a description, but this one is a quotation. Philosophers in those days generally thought it beneath them to discuss literature. Most of them would talk about grammar, would talk about principles of language, would talk about classics and philosophical works, but they would not talk about poetry. But Locke would be one of the first philosophers. Of course, there are others, They take their idea of poetry from the earlier critics, the ancient critics, but Locke seems to be talking directly about poetry in his own time. And this is the quotation. Poetry is a way of proceeding quite contrary to, or this is a way of proceeding quite contrary to metaphor and allusion. So what is poetry? Most of the contemporaries of Locke would say that poetry would be mainly to deal with metaphors and allusions. Allusion means references. Wherein for the most part lies that entertainment and pleasantry of wit, which strikes so lively on the fancy and therefore so acceptable to all people, because its beauty appears at first sight and there is required no labor of thought to examine what truth or reason there is in it. Now, he is disagreeing with most people who believe that poetry is metaphor and allusion. What he says is that poetry is entertainment and pleasantry of wit. If you read a poem and you feel entertained, you feel happy, your mood changes, you become more receptive to somebody else's points of view because you are happy. And pleasantry of wit, that you know the language excites the person to think more about the topic that is being touched upon in the poem. So the wit means the mind of the poet becomes active, of the reader of the poem becomes active, and that is what is poetry. So, and poetry is so lively on the fancy and therefore so acceptable to all people. Now, would you agree with this, that poetry actually believes in catering to the general requirements of the people? So poetry is not meant to be discussed in the classroom or you analyze poetry for purpose of exam or for the purpose of writing a book. But the main purpose of poetry is to be acceptable at the level of fancy to all people, he says, because its beauty appears at first sight. First sight means immediately, and there is required no labor of thought. So he is in a way drawing a line between thinking and feeling at the level of pleasure. So labor of thought is not required, but the truth and the reason are received at the level of pleasure. So it's a new idea, and this idea will be expanded by philosophers, not exactly in the 18th century, but in the 19th century particularly. And the readers of literature of the 19th century would bear me out that there was a whole school of aestheticians in the 19th century. Walter Pater is one of them, and these people talked about poetry as something that creates a sense of sweetness and beauty. So maybe that idea also came from here, and it is a philosopher who is talking about poetry here. Then, this is one of the most revolutionary ideas of Locke. This also relates with the not just the 19th century, but also the 20th century. And I read this statement: man being born with a title to perfect freedom. So we have a title, we have a right. You see, this right is guaranteed to us that we will be perfectly free. Now, can we say that we are perfectly free in a society in which we live? This question is worth pondering over. So, title to perfect freedom and uncontrolled enjoyment of all the rights and privileges of the law of nature. No one can be put out of this estate and subjected to the political power of another with his own consent. Suppose I ask this question from you. Would you agree that the earth should not give all its pleasures to you? Nobody will agree with this, because all of us should agree as humans and as people believing in equality, that the pleasures of the earth belong to all of us equally. And this is what he is saying. And a person saying in the 17th century all these things, when there is hierarchy, when there is royalty, or when there are kings and queens, when there are landlords, when there are rich merchants, and there are common people, peasants and artisans, etc., then all of them have their place in society. And in fact, governing people means to tell people all the time what their duties are and what their place is. But then this person is going hammer and tongs at these people, and he says that human beings have the title to perfect freedom and uncontrolled enjoyment. So in a way, this philosopher belongs more to the later periods than to the 17th century. And he, in his own time, is able to critique the idea of hierarchy. Now, I finish here the discussion on John Locke, but to tell you that if John Locke and people like him were not there in the 19th century, then things would have unfolded differently in the 18th and 19th centuries. Therefore, this is the point of departure, and this is where I thought I should, you know, bring in this particular philosopher for you to understand that the political events, the ideological development, and the theoretical evolution all will lead towards the 19th and 20th centuries, when these ideas will become common property and common knowledge. Now, we had done yesterday in the previous lecture certain aspects of Hegel's thought, and I had covered, for instance, aesthetics, religion, philosophy, history, philosophy of history, epistemology, and political philosophy. These I had discussed, and I will not repeat them. So I'll go to the next aspect of Hegel in the 19th century as to what he became concerned with, and the ideas that he worked upon. Some viewer yesterday asked this very interesting and good question regarding the meaning of the word dialectic. And I gave the answer that dialectic is a kind of law of human existence and life, and nature also, and that in nature and in human behavior, if you have a thing, if you have in view, if you have a development, you also have its opposite inherent in it. And the opposite starts working against the present view. So if the tension between an action and its opposite starts happening, then where is the solution? And Hegel would then give the solution, that the solution would lie then in their clash and the final resolution. So this is called the dialectical thing. I can give another example here to explain things a little more clearly, that when an employee works for an employer, then the employer needs the employee and gives money to him or her as salary. The employee needs the employer, and the employer needs the employee. So in a way, this should remain in a harmonious relationship. But all of us know at the same time that the employee feels exploited, that he is not being given the proper salary, and that the other person is becoming rich at his cost. So imagine that they need each other, at the same time they hate each other, at the same time they disbelieve each other. So this is called the dialectic. What is the solution to the dialectic? Hegel would say that the solution is that at some level both of them would agree on certain things through clash. Maybe the workers or the employees go on a strike, and their demands are met, and if the demands are met, then there will be harmony. Or on the other side, the employer can get some other workers and throw them out, so for him the peace of mind is assured. So this kind of a dialectic works in both the negative and the positive sense. But he says that the law is there, that if you have something, you must also have its opposite. So this is the Hegelian dialectic, and here I read it out. Hegel's dialectic was most often characterized as a three-step process: thesis, antithesis, synthesis. Namely, that a thesis, and he gives the example of thesis as the French Revolution. Suppose the French Revolution occurs, it would cause the creation of antithesis, its own opposite, that is, the reign of terror that followed, and would eventually result in a synthesis, that is, the constitutional state of free citizens. Now let's understand this dialectic from the Hegel's angle, from the angle of Hegel. French Revolution occurred, and a whole class was ousted. This was the class of the court, the landlords, and those who supported the king. The king himself was ousted from society. Then what would remain? A kind of vacuum may have been created, and that vacuum, people didn't know where to go and who would govern them, and on what principle would they operate in life. And therefore, for some time there was some sense of anarchy. This anarchy started working against the very idea of revolution that has caused the the ousting of the king. So you can see that there is an event and there is its opposite. But finally, certain leaders came up from the masses themselves, they started operating at the level of government, and then some kind of normalcy was restored in France after a decade or so. So this is called, according to Hegel, and Hegel was alive at that time. He was thinking about these issues, and he may have taken these examples to understand that this is how dialectics work in society. Now, at another level, then, dialectic is a law, and it's a theoretical law. It's a law that can be theoretically explained. Now, you can ask this question, and we can tackle it later, maybe in some other discussion. You can ask the question whether literature also has certain laws. We know about natural laws, we know about laws in history maybe, but does literature also have laws? Does literature also have a dialectic? Are there opposites in literature also? Is there harmony in literature? You know, all these questions, they become related then, and our approach to literature becomes not just critical, but theoretical, because we are now raising an issue which is about the rules that literature might follow indirectly or directly, knowingly or unknowingly, and that the writer also works under the pressure of these rules and laws like the dialectic. So interestingly, we have a direct connection now of theory with literature, in the sense that the question is raised whether literature has a dialectic or whether it just moves in one direction only and there are no problems in it. So this is where somehow we become clear about the working of the dialectic as Hegel would explain the term for us. Then it is further elaborated in the comment that follows. The thesis, antithesis, synthesis approach gives sense that things or ideas are contradicted or opposed by things that come from outside them. You know, generally we believe that if there is a problem, then effect of this problem will be on the world outside, and the world outside would oppose it. So a thing, the dialectic is outside the thing, is outside the situation. This was the usual idea about dialectic. But Hegel, gave a very fine, almost radical interpretation of dialectic by saying that the situation carries its own dialectic. The dialectic doesn't come from outside. The dialectic actually is inherent in the situation. So you think of the situation, and if you are not clear about this, then you will just leap in the dark and face a kind of music that you never anticipated. So Hegel would say that before you enter into a situation, before you enter into a particular process, remember that this process has a dialectic of its own, and that is inherent in it. So this is Hegel's contribution to the theory of the dialectic, that everything, every human behavior, part of conduct of a human being has an inner dialectic built into it. So it doesn't come from outside. To the contrary, he says, the fundamental notion of Hegel's dialectic is that things or ideas have internal contradictions. So another word is coming now. First it was dialectic, which meant the opposite, and now the word contradiction, which means more or less the same thing. From Hegel's point of view, analysis or comprehension of a thing or ideas reveals that underneath it, its apparently simple identity or unity is an underlying inner contradiction. So, we should not just believe our eyes, we should not just believe our first feeling, we should not, we should not understand a thing by its appearance, but should also examine the nature of the particular event and the problems that it might create, because your own decision may have a dialectic hidden in it, and that dialectic should be thought about. Now, Urvashi, am I clear about dialectic, or is there something that can be raised in this particular case?
Sir, as you were sharing the idea of the dialectic, I was once again intrigued and found it very interesting how that even human actions can have a dialectic. Sir, you just gave the example of the French Revolution. You said the thesis, antithesis, and the synthesis. So, could you give an example, that deals with some incident from daily life, any instance of human behavior which has these three aspects?
Well, one day you are enjoying your life, your time, and you can go to the library at the time you like, etc. And the next day you take up a job so that I know you can look after your own interest and ensure independence. But the moment you take your job, the new dialectic appears. That dialectic is that you will be going to that place at 10 o'clock. You leave that place at an appointed time, and that you will be working under the pressure of somebody else. So you started by the idea of winning or gaining freedom. And the next day you found that instead of freedom you got a kind of slavery. So that's the dialectic. That will know how to resolve this dialectic. Then you have to think of further ways. Maybe there is a harmony, maybe there is no harmony. So that's what dialectic is.
Okay. I can totally relate to that and understand that idea. Thank you for the example, sir.
And this is there in the case of all the decisions that we make. The moment you take a decision, you realize that, you know, perhaps there is a problem. Now, that was a simple example. The bigger example, particularly for a woman, is the example of marriage. That, you know, before marriage, all women think, you know, that marriage is the last word and marriage is a very good thing, etc. And, you know, you will be leaving the parental pressure and going to a world where you will be the king or the queen, etc. And then you marry and you realize that you have just changed homes. The woman has just changed homes. Otherwise, the slavery continues. So that way, but you know, it doesn't mean that harmony cannot be established. Then, of course, you will go with this feeling. You know that marriage has these problems, etc. So you can, of course, create your own atmosphere elsewhere also.
Absolutely.
So that's where it happens.
That's
but that a decision has its own dialectic is there. It is to be recognized very clearly. So this is what he says, that in all situations, and these situations are also the stuff of literature. So when you are writing a book, when you are writing a novel, when you are writing a play, then you also must realize that when you introduce a new situation, that situation will come with its own logic and with its own problems, which could not be anticipated earlier. So there will be a dialectic, and in fact, that is the fun of life, and that is the fun of literature.
Sir, could I intervene once more? I wanted to ask that before Hegel had introduced this idea, did writers, when introducing a situation talking about a particular event, did they pay attention to this idea that every event or say every situation would involve thesis, antithesis? Did they pay so much attention, or even after Hegel introduced, did they become very alert or aware about this dialectic?
This is an interesting question. What you are saying is that before Newton told us that there is law of gravity, apples would not fall on the earth. Apple, of course, would fall on the earth. What I mean is that human beings and writers and philosophers always knew that these things were there, but the law was not clear to them. You know, the job of the philosopher or the thinker or the theorist is to discover the law, to study the law. Now, this law is studied by Hegel as the law of the dialectic. Of course, the one of the best dialecticians or people, you know, who believes in this kind of contradiction is the ancient philosopher Plato, and Socrates. These people, you know, always go to the other side of the picture, so they know about it. But then, the way Hegel in the 19th century is able to relate the dialectic to the situation of his time, that way things have not been done. So your question is absolutely valid, that dialectic works in nature, dialectics works in society, but then it has to be revealed by, it has to be studied by, it has to be investigated by, examined, and then established by somebody who knows theory. This is the purpose of theory. So those people did not have theory at their command, and they were observing it, and through observation they were able to grasp the dialectic then. So this is how it works.
Thank you, sir.
So then I go to the next point. Already the idea of contradiction has been introduced, and I would say that to begin with, dialectic and contradiction should be seen more or less interchangeably. You can use them one for the other. So contradictions work in life. All life is the coexistence of different contradictions. You can say that. So this contradiction leads to the dissolution of the thing or idea in the simple form in which it presented itself, and to higher level, more complex thing or idea that more adequately incorporates the contradiction. And then, you know, this thesis, antithesis, and synthesis, this is a triangle. And this word triangle is used here in the quotation as triadic. So the triadic form that appears in many places in Hegel, and Hegel is a dialectical thinker. So first he talks of being, then he talks of nothingness, then he talks of becoming. So human beings are born, then they are beings, but then that they know that the world doesn't mean anything to them, but they, and therefore they start thinking about it, and then they become human beings. So see the dialectic here: being, nothingness, and becoming. Immediate, mediate, concrete. You face a situation, and then you mediate into it, you intervene into it, and then concrete reality emerges through your struggle. These are the ways in which dialectic can be understood. Abstract, negative, concrete. First you think generally, after that you go into the difficulties, problems, and that difficulty or the problem that gives you a very close, clear idea, non-abstract idea of the reality. Is about this movement from inner contradiction to higher level integration or unification. So in fact, Hegel thought that through the dialectical method, you could understand the process of progress in life. And this is where I think it was a very good kind of idea that Hegel could at that time explicate, and it became current in philosophy. And there will be philosophers later who would go into the dialectic of Hegel and would further improve on it, and we'll take them up separately later. The important works of Hegel then, the phenomenology of spirit. Now this again is a new word. He was talking about the phenomena and of the spirit, not of the body or the physical self of a person. Science of logic, it's a new term. Generally you could not combine science with logic. Logic was generally philosophy, and science was something which was empirical. But then in the dialectical way, you can connect the two opposites also. So science of logic is a kind of dialectical statement, and it's a book. Lectures on aesthetics, he started talking about the theory of literature, which is aesthetics, and philosophy of history. These are the books that Hegel wrote, and then he was able to enlighten fellow scholars and the common thinking people of the time along lines of rationality and things connected with them. So Hegel is a turning point in the evolution of theory in the 19th century, because he has started talking of laws, he has started talking of principles and rules, and he's in a way synthesizing apparently discordant or inconsistent areas like philosophy and science. Then we take up two or three more people, and today I'll sum up the discussion of all these people, putting them together and making a view which is a bit comprehensive. We have a philosopher in England, and fascinating aspect of English philosophers is that they are generally very close to the affairs of the state. This starts happening from Thomas More onwards, who is the Lord Chancellor, from Francis Bacon. They are philosophers, and they are people of the state. And here the same case is there with John Stuart Mill in the 19th century. He is a philosopher, and he is also connected with the affairs of the state. In fact, the person was the employee of the East India Company that had to, at that point of time, manage the affairs of India. That's not relevant for us today, so we'll discuss him as a philosopher. He's an Englishman, a philosopher, political economist. Now see the contradictions here. Can a philosopher be a political economist? A political economist would be studying economics in its political manifestation, as to how economy can be improved in such a manner that political harmony can be achieved through it. And a political theorist, so philosopher coming to politics, studying economics, and then combining all these three into a unified understanding. The books written by him include On Liberty, a philosopher talking of liberty. Generally philosophers explain, but this philosopher goes to the people and tell them that their job is to attain and acquire as much liberty in society as possible. The Subjection of Women. This is a very important topic. In fact, in the 19th century English literature, you have this trend of women's liberation coming up in a slightly different form. But then here you have a male, who is talking for the rights of women. And he is writing this book in 1863. Then you have utilitarianism as a book. And utilitarianism was a philosophy of the 19th century. And this philosophy connected very directly with the economic reality of the time. And the principles of political economy, these are the books he wrote. His interests include political philosophy, ethics, economics, inductive logic. So I think a bell rings in our mind that inductive logic, the logic of the empirical kind where you learn from experience. Inductive logic means that you learn from experience. Whatever you went through, you start thinking about it. And if you repeat that action again the next time, then you will do better than before because you would have thought about it. That's called the inductive logic. So with every repetition, your knowledge of the phenomena will increase and you will be reaching a better state of understanding that thing. So he's a, that way he's a part of the chain that began, that begins in Europe in the Renaissance period. And all these interests that I have presented to you, they all connect him with the Renaissance emphases that began in the 14th, 15th centuries. Now I'll just introduce a few points that he brought into the social domain. The book on liberty involves an impassioned defense of free speech. Now this is quite relevant to us in India today. All of us want free speech. If there are controversies, if books are banned, if articles are banned, etc., then that involves a kind of encroachment on the rights of people to free speech. And he, in the 19th century, is talking about free speech. And Mill argues that free discourse is a necessary condition for intellectual and social progress. So unless you have free speech, unless you have a free discussion, unless you have the right to argue with your opponent, and in such a manner that both you and your opponent are benefited by it, without that, social progress and intellectual progress cannot be guaranteed. So this is a point which is very revolutionary, and this is a point that is quite relevant to us even today. Then further, we can never be sure, he contends, that a silenced opinion does not contain some element of the truth. So don't silence an opinion, don't oppress an opinion, because that also may have some truth in it. So the better thing would be, even if somebody is wrong, you should ask the wrong person to speak out, to share one's views, so that you can argue with that person, and that way you can make him clear about the problems that he faces within himself. So he's a very enlightened kind of a person who believes in mutual tolerance and mutual learning. He also argues that allowing people to air false opinions is productive for two reasons, and he gives two reasons for that. So allow, you see, if somebody is wrong, don't shut him up. If somebody is wrong, then ask him or her to tell what one has to say. And if the thing is said, then it enters once again the social domain, and there different people can participate in the discussion and reach the right kind of conclusion. But he says, you allow people to speak their wrong opinions also, and he gives two reasons. These two reasons are, first, individuals are more likely to abandon erroneous beliefs if they are engaged in an open exchange of ideas. So sometime after half an hour of discussion, after 2 days of discussion, maybe the person who was wrong will finally understand that he or she was wrong. Second, by forcing other individuals to re-examine and reaffirm their beliefs in the process of debate, these beliefs are kept from declining into mere dogma. If you suppress a person, if you shut a person, shut up a person, if you don't allow him or her to speak, then this person will sit in a corner and brood over things. And his or her opinion of the wrong idea will be further strengthened, and it will become a dogma. And that dogma may be dangerous for the society as a whole. So it is better that the person is airing one's views, and then, of course, it will not become a dogma. It can become something that is questionable. I think that's a good idea. And this once again relates to us, and particularly in literature. Because in literature, writers sometimes say things which are not palatable to a large number of people. Then should this writer be compelled to shut shop? Should his book be banned? This is a question that is directly relevant to us, and there are debates all the time going on in the newspapers about these things. But the right path is shown by this thinker, that such a person should be given a chance to express oneself. Now, even though he was a philosopher and he knew so many right kind of things, then, but he said a few things which at least Indians would not easily digest. He said at one place, despotism is a legitimate mode of government in dealing with barbarians. Now he is taking upon himself the responsibility of defining who barbarians are. In fact, in the view of the in the idea of the East India Company, Indians were barbarians, and it was the white man's burden or white man's responsibility to educate us. So therefore, he was giving this idea to the East India Company that it is our job to dictate to these people, should be their dictators, and should try to lift their level and make them civilized. So this idea somehow we can. By taking his own logic, we should not ban his books, etc., but we should definitely discuss these things and prove him right or wrong, depending on the worth of his argument. Mill was, and this point I'd like to slightly explain. Mill was one of the earliest women's rights advocates. He has commented on three major facets of women's lives that he felt are hindering them. Now, women generally feel blocked by certain trends in society. And what are those trends? He very clearly tells them. He says society generally comes in the way, and gender construction. Are women different from men? Now, all of us, you know, have our views on this, that they are different from us. And how are they different, and how are they women? Aren't women human beings? If they are human beings, then why call them women? Why divide humanity into two parts, saying that one part is male and the other part is female? And then, you know, we invent all kinds of arguments to say that one is a woman and the other is a man. Now, this person would give this that term gender construction. A woman is born a woman, but then call that a woman, is she. That's a gender construction, and this is done by grammar, which is also human made. So this gender construction generally suppresses women, he says, and he's very right. Sometime later, we will have a whole discussion on the feminist approach in literature, where we will discuss this question. But this person seems to be one of the first in England to come out openly to say that it was not God who creates women, but that it is humans themselves who define women and therefore create them as a matter of gender construction. The second blocking in the case of women that happened, according to him, was through education. You give a wrong kind of education to them. You give, by education, he means the wrong ideas. You say that one is a woman and the other is a man, and then the reasons are given. And one reason I have included one of his essays in a book that I edited, and there he says that women are told that they are weak all the time in the classroom. In the marketplace, at home, in society, etc., that women are weak. And then he gives example, please prove how women are weak. And then he gave lots of examples, and you can't prove that women are weak. But then this is seen as the scientific truth, established scientific truth by all of us, because a wrong kind of education is given to people. And the third thing he says is marriage. Marriage works almost always invariably against the interest of a woman, because a woman is subjected to the second-rate citizenship by marriage. And he once again argues for this. There are large number of feminists today who decry marriage, who suggest to women that they should not marry because it's a kind of a tangle. And it may be wrong or right, but then these ideas are now very much there for us to debate. And Mill was one of the first, one of the pioneers of this idea. He felt that the oppression of women was one of the few remaining relics from ancient times. In ancient times, these things were practiced, but then the relic has remained, a set of prejudices that severely impeded the progress of humanity. Of course, the argument that he gave in one of his essays was that if you keep a whole population of 50% illiterate, then society will suffer, because this population will be completely unproductive. It is this, that is implied by the idea that the wrong kind of policies in society and the wrong kind of the prejudices in society, they impede the progress of humanity. Any comment on this from your side?
Sir, absolutely. So while you were also talking about this, I was thinking in my mind that somebody who's so progressive and he's thinking of so many evolved ideas at the time when he's thinking and writing, and I found that contrasting to his idea of what that he calls women as Indians and as barbaric. I found that quite striking in terms of what he thinks. But we also probably cannot discount his views because he himself advocates that if somebody is wrong, we should let them speak, and once they've spoken their bit, they will themselves realize that it's wrong.
And yes, I think you pointed this out very clearly. You see, it's not necessary that if a person is open-minded, one is all the time right. In fact, all of us at some point of time make mistakes, but the way that mistake can be corrected is that things are discussed, and he's for freedom, he's for liberty. So with liberty, all the wrongs can be debated properly, and many of them can be set right. But then if you stop these people from not saying what they want to say, then things will become much more harmful. This is exactly, you have very rightly pointed out that even the best philosophers will make certain mistakes, but then they also leave scope for discussion because other philosophers will come and correct them.
Yes.
That's what, and maybe he was able to, he made those statements because he was at that point of time an advocate of the East India Company. Suppose he lived in a different kind of a group, and he was critical of the East India Company, then he wouldn't have said this.
Yes.
So in a way, he's proving through his behavior that certain structures in society, like marriage in the case of women, the example he has given, the certain structures of society, for instance, there is a structure in society that operates at the level of economic suppression, like East India Company. If you are a part of that, then you are bound to say wrong things. So that idea also becomes clear through this kind of a behavior.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Then, this question we can also discuss today. happiness is of two kinds, he says. One happiness is the lower kind of happiness, that you enjoy, you eat, drink and be merry. The other kind of happiness is that you think and you create ideas. Now, the first happiness is simple happiness. The second happiness is a difficult happiness, because then you have to read, you have to think, you have to analyze, and you have to say, you should have the courage to say things. And sometimes, one lacks courage to say the right thing. So therefore, you also jeopardize your chances of security in society by saying correct things, because that will cost a price. So that way, which happiness is better and which is not? Now, so for some philosophers, all happinesses are alike. But this person says, no, there are two kinds of happiness, the lower kind of happiness and the higher kind of happiness. So I'll read this out and then proceed. Mills defines the difference between higher and lower forms of happiness with the principle that those who have experienced both tend to prefer one over the other. Now he's stating a fact. Mill also argues that people who, for example, are noble or practice philosophy benefit society more than those who engage in individualist practices for pleasure, which are lower forms of happiness. It's not the agent's own greatest happiness that matters, but the greatest amount of happiness altogether. So the philosopher, the political activist, the economist, the jurist, these people are all the time working for a general kind of happiness, and for that they are burning midnight oil, and they are staking their own health and enjoyment. But then, since they are working for the happiness of all, so their happiness, the happiness caused by them or the happiness that they enjoy, that is a better kind of happiness. So even on happiness, the philosopher has something to say, and this actually is a matter which is very close to a poem, let's say, or a play, because the play is a matter of happiness, and what kind of happiness does a play give? Now there is a happiness, now you go into the literary theory, there is a kind of happiness that also emanates from tragedy. This is what Aristotle would say more than 2000 years ago. And then if he is able to say this, then how can tragedy give happiness? And literary theory has to answer this question. So these ideas then finally merge with the ideas that are expressed in literature. I take the last but one philosopher here, Charles Darwin. He is the last perhaps, yes. I'll take him in brief. I still Well, I'll just spend a sentence or so on this.
So we do have a few minutes.
We do have
3 to 4 minutes.
Okay.
At least.
So yes. I'll just take a minute to just read through and see. Darwin's family tradition was nonconformist utilitarian, which means that he was not that way into the doctrine of the divine. So he was a nonconformist, a person who didn't agree, and that he was a utilitarian. He bothered about the happiness that is to be given through products that the society produced, and this was a popular philosophy in the 19th century. For your information, viewers, let me tell you that this utilitarian philosophy inspired a large number of writers in the 19th century to write about it. And one of the best examples of writing on the theme of utilitarianism is the novel by Charles Dickens called Hard Times. There he takes up the entire philosophy of utilitarianism for fictional depiction, and it's one of the most powerful novels that he has written. Then Darwin was strongly against slavery. Already, Urvashi, your question has been answered. Somebody calls somebody else as a barbarian and his contemporary, Charles Darwin, an Englishman, is strongly against slavery, against ranking the so-called races of man as distinct species, and against ill treatment of native people. So what that person was advocating, the other philosopher, the other scientist, that person takes things critically and then comes to
yes,
this.
Sir.
One sentence about he actually established evolution of humanity as a scientifically established as a scientific fact.
Yes. Hello. Sir, if you would allow, we could take a call from UP.
Yes, that will be good.
Can we please have the question?
Hello,
please tell us where are you calling from and your name.
My name is Sunil Kumar.
आप कहाँ से बात कर रहे हैं?
मैं सुनील सुनील बोल रहा हूँ from UP.
Okay, please ask your question.
मैं I go what are the views about utilitarianism?
Views about utilitarianism?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you so much. But do you want to tell us whose views?
I think
so it got disconnected.
The question is what exactly is utilitarianism, and I can explain the meaning of utilitarianism. That you know, human beings, societies produce things in for utility, and that no moral, ethical principles involved in it. So you judge things by how they are useful.
Okay.
And if you go by that logic, then of course you will ensure the happiness of the largest number of people.
Right.
That's what utilitarianism
is. Sir, I would now request you to probably resume the discussion in our next lecture, because we've come to the end of this lecture. Unfortunately, I wish we had more time and we could talk more about Charles Darwin. But since this is a series, we will take this up in the next lecture. So first of all, thank you, sir, for being here and for telling us so much about literary theory and the evolution of literary theory and talking about the different thinkers and philosophers and making this seem like not so much of a difficult task to learn about theory. And so many of us may feel scared, but I would also feel scared at times, but now I feel that it's not such a heavy task to learn about theory. So thank you, sir, and thank you for all the callers and the listeners. We will be tuned in again and we could talk more on literary theory. Thank you and have a nice day.